The Exton Moss Experiment. Adventures in Wine and Space with Simon Exton and Ken Moss. Episode 58. Doctor Who, The Tenth Planet.
Hello everyone, and a very warm welcome to the Exton Moss Experiment. I'm Ken Moss.
I'm Simon Exton.
And tonight we're going to get around to Doctor Who, The Tenth Planet, in memoriam of Earl Cameron, who's died at the age of 102. Now, he is the oldest actor ever to have been in Doctor Who. He was the very I'm reliably informed, the very first black astronaut anywhere on telly, anywhere in the world. That was part of his obituary on the Doctor Who news page, and they're usually pretty accurate.
I think he was the first black actor to play a lead role in a feature film as well.
Which was?
I can't remember. Mm. There might be something more specific about it than that, in that it was the first lead action role in a feature film or something. But he was quite a big deal anyway, which is why we're doing this in memoriam, even though he's only in a couple of the episodes.
It's also a good excuse to watch The Tenth Planet.
There is that.
Now, before we start, of course, we have to get the lid off the gin bottle. Tonic screwdriver out. What have we got for tonight?
We have Ninth Wave Irish Gin, distilled from nature's finest botanicals in a very, very nice looking bottle with swirly stuff over it. God, the info bollocks is particularly bollocksy this time. In Celtic mythology, the ninth wave is the barrier that separates the earthly world from the other world. It is said to be greater than any other wave before it and holds the key to unlocking your journey. Product of Ireland, and the botanicals are cassia bark, lemon verbena, orange peel, cardamom, grains of paradise, juniper berries, coriander seeds, angelica root, and orris roots. There's nothing actually wildly innovative there. What do you think?
I'm not keen. It's, now I'm going to say I'm not keen because it's just not to my palate. It's a little bit sharp and it leaves quite a bitter aftertaste. But it's not a bad gin. It's just not to my taste. So for that reason, me personally, I'm going to give it 2, but it's quite sharp.
I think it has quite a nasty bitterness after it. Sharpness, no, not really, but there's that slightly overdone bitter aftertaste. So for me, I think that's a 3.
Because we've had some nasty gins.
We have.
This isn't badly made. It's just, not to my taste.
Would probably make a very nice pink gin.
Yeah, maybe with the edge knocked off it, possibly.
But we're not assessing these on their ability to make pink gins. We're assessing them on their ability to tonic up a screwdriver.
So here we are back in the viewing room. Spaff has got his... Oh, what are you on tonight, Spaff?
That is no concern of yours.
Chili rice crackers. So without further ado, it's Rum VT on episode 1. Now, for those who aren't aware, The Tenth Planet was William Hartnell's last story as the first Doctor, and it's the second story of season 4 from 1966.
And the only one that in that fourth filming block that William Hartnell made, because The Smugglers was made at the end of the third filming block and held over.
Well, I thought the script was held over. I don't think that they filmed it and held it over. I thought it was just the script.
Okay.
Could be wrong with that.
I mean, that does make more sense, considering the way that it was produced. From what we've seen of the restaged...
The ones for Twice Upon a Time.
They look absolutely spot on. Don't they?
See, there is a lot of that that hasn't been released on DVD or Blu-ray. I don't know why.
Unless they're saving it for somebody. So there he is.
Earl Cameron.
How old did Olaf Pooley live to? Because he was over 100.
He was. I think he was 102, but...
Not as far into it as
Earl Cameron. Because the third oldest is It's some extra or something from something like the Crusade or something. I did look her up the other day, but she was 101.
Wasn't the woman who played Kamika pretty long-lived in Deus Ex?
Don't know. There's a list, actually. Again, on the doctor. Of course there's a list. Now, looking at this, apart from some fairly directed snow, that's a pretty good set.
Yeah, and as it pulls further back, you can see where
the snow machine, is.
But actually, it looks pretty good.
Now, unless my memory's playing tricks, that picture quality looks a lot better than the picture quality of the clip they used in Twice Upon a Time.
It's difficult to see why it would be, although, this is very good picture quality, isn't it?
Mm. The snow lying on the ground was sawdust, while the snow was bits of polystyrene being blown around, which Michael Cray has got jammed up his nose, and that's how one of the makeup ladies, Edwina, whatever her name was, that's how they married. They got together and got married.
Well, you can tell how engaging this is, because we haven't really said very much.
See, I've always given 10th Planet a bit of a bad rep as being a bit dull.
I mean, the story makes very little sense, other than the Cybermen, which are a fantastic invention, but really come into their own later. Oh, Kip Pedler contributed to Tomorrow's World. I hadn't known that. Pedler came up with the basic ideas. So the whole extra planet thing doesn't seem wildly scientific.
I think the idea that it's been hidden behind the sun all this time.
Oh, no, drifted off, on a journey into outer space and then drifted back again. Might Big Finish have come up with an...
Big Finish, I think, in Spare Parts, which is a fifth Doctor story.
Is excellent.
It is excellent.
Doesn't explain what happened with Mondas.
Well, it was hidden behind... That's probably where I've got the hidden behind the sun bit from. It was hidden behind the sun and then drifted out of the solar system, but they built a planetary propulsion system, which is how it's drifted back. It's more been flown back. It's still a hell of a stretch of scientific imagination, though.
See, Ben looking terribly serious, and although he's on parade, Polly desperately trying not to laugh.
Apparently, Robert Basie was a lot of fun off recording, and there's one of the others. Dr. Barclay, I think, in this. You'd never think to look at it because he's playing it so well. He was really an absolute riot in the green room.
His hat's had a very jaunty
end. It is a bit rich. That ish. Suddenly, after being really severe with them all, it's quite jovial and jocular. There's only really the general that never really warms up.
Yeah. ...1986, which for them just seemed wildly far in the future, and now seems a long way in the past.
Mm. Mind you, at least the 20... They've not imagined wildly technological advances in 20 years, which is what they usually do.
I was going to say that's a terrible boom mic coming in, but it isn't. It's their little periscope thing coming in.
The little periscope.
I mean, this space capsule set doesn't actually look wildly improved from the one in Quatermass 2.
No.
Okay, the stamina of the astronauts looks a little improved.
Mm. See, this is what I like about 1960s science fiction, particularly Star Trek. Star Trek was always, without any sort of force, just very multicultural.
Mm.
And no one's really, in all the years that I've been a fan of Doctor Who, no one's ever really made a big deal of Earl Cameron being black. It's only in recent years that everyone's really focused in on it. Up to this point, he's just been an actor in it, and to be honest, that I prefer that sort of view. He's just an actor in it who happens to be, rather than focusing on his skin colour. Because he is easily one of the best things in it, but that's because he's a good actor.
Yeah. And it does come just one story after The Smugglers, where a very big deal is made in the story about the fact that one of the characters is black.
Well, yeah, but that's pertinent to the time. That's set in... Is it 17th century or 18th century Cornwall? I love the smugglers so much.
17th century, I think it's sort of Jamaica and Daphne du Maurier.
See, I'm really partial to that sort of thing. I love anything piratical. I loved Treasure Island, the novel. I think I read that in 2 days when I was in my early teens.
Quite like Jamaica Inn.
I'm ashamed to say I've never read it.
I read loads of Daphne du Maurier when I lived in Cornwall.
Well, I've read Rebecca, and is Genevieve one of those? I can't remember now.
Can't remember. The House on the Strand is. That's quite an interesting time travel-y thing. It was the last thing that she wrote.
Right. No, I don't know that one.
Because she either did sort of historically type stuff or science fiction-y type stuff.
Did she?
Well, she did The Birds.
Oh, sort of, sort of fantastical.
House on the Strand is a time travel thing.
That I did not know. So I was having a Twitter conversation with one of the Big Finish writers a few weeks back about 10th Planet.
Mm.
And I put forward the idea that the Doctor basically is the first representation on screen of a Doctor Who fan here. He writes something cryptic on a note, passes it around that he knows something they don't, and never explains how he knew, where he got the information from. He just retreats into the background and watches the ensuing chaos without ever explaining what he meant. These two are doing the level best to do astronaut in peril acting, and it comes across quite well. They look knackered.
He is putting a fantastic performance in. And actually, the tracking room is very nicely done as well, isn't it? Space fatigue.
Yes, you can make anything sound science fiction by putting space in front of it.
Oh, did William Hartnell live in Bodmin?
No, he was on holiday in Bodmin. Yeah. They say, after recently completing work on the smugglers, so...
It's quite a big set, the way it goes back, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
You
know what this planet is. Well, what is... Well, I'm not quite
sure, sir. Let me have another look into this instrument. You say you know what this is. Well, actually, I don't. It looks just like Venezia. Give over. Of all the recognisable bits on the globe, she recognises Malaysia.
I'm glad it's not just me that's thought that over the years.
Ben, oh, that looks like South America. Yes, fair enough. That looks like Africa, but that looks like Malaysia.
So it can't be. There's nothing to reflect on. And now, my dear Dr. Barclay, I suggest you look at that piece of paper. How did you know? Well, I can't tell you that.
Now, you clearly know something more about the situation. Can you be more explicit?
Yes, sir, I'm sorry. I'm afraid I can.
Well, there's just no explanation about how he knows all of this.
None
stuff,
at all.
Ever. And it doesn't stop it being an engaging story.
I've always said the Doctor doesn't have anything to do in this story, really. They all turn up. Beyond Ben, I don't think any of them actually do anything.
No, Polly does a lot of... she does the whole emotions speech with this girl. The Cybermen.
But what I mean is they're not integral to, they don't have any influence on the outcome.
But actually there's quite a lot of Doctor Who stories that are like that.
Well, Revelation of the Daleks is the one that springs to mind.
Oh, and it says it's unusual to have him playing such
a limited role. Well, I suppose the massacre's another one. There's not really a lot of, in fact, there's hardly anything in there. It's just a nice set piece.
All of the historicals, because they're dealing with established historical fact, and they don't really alter the plot very much, apart from bits of the Romans.
I'm going to say the Romans.
And it's actually a plot point in the Aztecs that they can't alter anything. He's very craggy in this, isn't he?
Yes. But he never... For all the talk of what went on off screen, I don't doubt it for a minute, he never looks on screen ill or tired, or his performances are sharp in this as it was in An Unearthly Child.
Yes. Now, there's a shot of the Cyberman spaceship landing, and it's actually a much nicer model spaceship than the one that turns up in the moon base.
What, the pie cans? There's on Facebook at the minute, on the TARDIS Builders page, there have been a lot of old photographs dug out and it shows the various TARDIS props. Now, bear in mind that this original, that's the original TARDIS prop, and it lasts until 1974, 75. Made out of wood, and it stood the test of time with a bit of tweaking here and there.
Yeah, didn't it fall apart around Elizabeth Sladen?
Yes, it did. Which, given the weight of the thing... Go on.
I was going to say, the arrival of the Cybermen is very atmospheric, isn't it?
But the Brahatsky TARDIS prop, a lot more durable than the... Is it Tom Yardley Jones? The fiberglass prop they made for the Leisure Hive, the brand new one. And you look at pictures, and by full circle... The bloody thing's fallen apart. It just looks shabby. So build your tie-dye out of wood, kids.
Build your what?
Tie-dye.
TARDISes. It doesn't end in US, it ends in IS.
$5.5 million viewers, 77th in the weekly chart. 5.5 million now will put it quite a way above that. Audience reaction index was only 50%.
And improved on the previous stories.
Well, that was episode one. I'd ask what did you think, but since we were mute for great chunks of it, I think that probably speaks volumes, to be honest.
But before we do, before we talk about what we think about it, should we do a pricey?
Oh, you're better at this than I am. Go on.
Right. Okay, so the TARDIS with the Dr. Ben and Polly on board arrive at the South Pole just outside a military base called the Snowcap Base, run by General Custer.
Cutler.
Oops. Could have been worse. I could have said Captain Custer. Which would have been the road to Utopia. And there's a lot of snow in that.
No,
well.
Let's not go down that route.
It's a snowcap base run by General Cutler. They go inside, encouraged to at gunpoint, and they find out that it's a military base and predominantly looking after spaceships in orbit. There's a spaceship currently up in orbit that is starting to get into trouble with an odd energy drain. At the same time, a new planet appears close to the Earth, and they realise that it looks exactly the same in terms of land masses as the Earth. And the Doctor's all terribly mysterious and knowing, and gives over a bit of paper saying, this is what you will see, and never actually explains how he knows what he knows. It's just, I know this thing. Ha! And then when they come back and say, well, how do you know about it? Let me have a look at this. All the information you've got. So he's trying to sort of inveigle himself into the action that way, but actually the regulars do very little. They get captured and they get shoved away in a corner. There's then another spaceship that arrives in quite a nice model shot, actually. And what we now know is the first Cybermen come out, kill a few guards who are outside investigating the TARDIS, and use the guards' snow coveralls to infiltrate the base.
Yes. It's not the best disguise in the world, given that the Cybermen are about 7 foot tall.
But everybody else was a little bit distracted. And they did make the point earlier on that there were very few people there because the general likes to run a very tight ship, and they all go bonkers after about 2 months and have to leave.
Beyond the fact that there was hardly anything for the... And I think this is, to be fair, the regulars don't do a lot in this. So I think even by the end of episode four... There's not an awful lot goes on, and it's been levelled at this over the years quite consistently by various people. But it's far more entertaining than I remember. I haven't seen this since it was on VHS.
I've always quite liked 10th Planet, in large part because it's a big chunk of Ben and Polly's surviving material. I really like Ben and Polly, but they don't do a lot.
Should we find out what happens in episodes 2 and 3 and come back?
So episodes 2 and 3 carry on with the TARDIS crew not doing a whole lot. The Doctor keels over at the end of the second episode and spends the entirety of the third episode under a blanket. Of all the regulars, Ben has the most to do because he gets a couple of times managed to get hold of cyber weapons and kill them. And
he's quite upset by the fact that... Because he just warned that he doesn't really want to do it.
But it's the first time he kills anything. He didn't in the War Machines. He doesn't in the Smugglers.
But he's visibly affected by it.
So with Ben's help, they managed to get rid of all the Cybermen from the base. Cutler takes back control. In the meantime, the two astronauts that they were trying to rescue have run out of energy and died. And a rescue mission was sent up with twice the resources of the original, manned by Cutler's son. Cutler decides that he's going to use a planet-cracking bomb called the Z-bomb against Mondas. The Doctor is absolutely adamant that what they need to do is just wait and let things play out, but Cutler won't hear it. The TARDIS team have convinced Barclay, one of the engineers, to help out, and he tells Ben how to sabotage the rocket that is going to
deliver
the bomb to blow up Mondas. And Ben is discovered in the rocket room just as he's in the middle of doing that, gets knocked out by Cutler, and just as the rocket countdown is going along as episode 3 finishes, Ben saying he can't remember whether he's done what he needed to or not. And there we have the end
of episode 3.
Again, they're not fast-paced, but they're quite compelling.
Watching them back again after all this time, I was... because I've got the audio version. I've got a lovely CD tin set years ago with this Planet of the Daleks and some Dalek documentary, I think. I wasn't wildly blown away by it because, as you say, it's quite slow. Nothing really happens. Everything happens at a very sort of leisurely pace. The Cybermen, they're not really in episode 3. They turn up in episode 2, do a bit. They're sort of padding about in the background in episode 3, but not really a major part of the action. But watching it back, I've not been bored for a second.
Yeah. I mean, the Geneva Space Control sets look really tacked on.
They do, but they're not shabby. It's not a desk in a corner.
Yeah.
They've made the effort to make them look like some sort of world control centre.
But it is obviously quite a small set.
It is.
Yeah. And probably because they've needed to use up all the space for the main control room, which does look great.
Think of the sets that they had in part one. They've got the control room, the snow cap, the TARDIS control room. I think they had the snow cap for the week after. The control room, the rocket room. So considering the size of the sets, what they crammed into, they were very small studios, really. Mm. You look back, you wonder how they even look in this state at all. It's always been levelled at Doctor Who. It's been a bit cheap. The budgets weren't brilliant, but I don't think it's any worse than any other 60s series that we've watched.
No, I agree. We grew up watching this stuff, so we're kind of used to it. You just wonder what fans who've only known the modern stuff think when looking at this.
It seems very likely, because a while back on a podcast, we had an interview with Rich Tipple, who is one of the people behind a fan colourisation of Dalek's Master Plan Episode 2. And although nothing's been officially confirmed at this point, it seems fairly likely that, beavering on behind the scenes, black and white episodes of Doctor Who are being coloured for commercial releases. I really hope they are, because I think that it will bring a lot of those old stories to life, not only on screen, but also commercially.
The arc would look quite good.
Even though I'm not too fond of it, yes, I think it would, because there's some great... they're not jungles, it's sort of the actual ship sets, there's trees and whatnot on it, aren't there?
Yeah,
is that the one with an elephant and a tiger in it?
Yes. And also there's the prison kitchen. And the sort of castle-y set on Refusis.
Yes.
The Ark is a very nice-looking story if you can look beyond the monoids.
I've never had a major problem with them, apart from the fact they're all... the only distinguishing feature they've got is a sash. Mm-hmm.
They have numbers.
Yes, I know, that's the only... Anyway, but I always thought that all things considered, the eye moves. They've at least made the effort. It's not just sort of a painted-on eye. So I've always been quite forgiving of the monoids. It's just never gripped me as a really entertaining story, although that was another one that was split in... It was a four-part story split into two-parters.
Yeah.
And a nice use of time travel, which they never really did that much in the earlier stuff.
Chase?
That was more a journey through time than...
Well, that's kind of what time travel is.
You know what I mean. But it wasn't an A follows B consequence story, because they shifted from locations as well.
Other than the arc, do they ever do that?
Well, this Nerva, that's same location, different times. But you mean in terms of an actual
I suppose Abominable Snowman and Web of Fear.
That's a direct line. There's supposed to be 40 years between the two. Does Peladon count? I know you'd rather it didn't count at all.
I like Curse of Peladon.
Curse, yes, but Monster you've always been reasonably unforgiving about.
It's one of those four-part stories stretched over six parts with an absolutely dreadful actress in the...
It's been so long since I've seen it, I can't remember.
Queen Tuttybutton is terrible, absolutely terrible.
Without further ado, dragging it back to something we do want to watch, shall we play episode four?
Yes, I think we should. So unlike the Macro Terror, they haven't animatified the title sequence. And actually, without the face in it, they don't really need to.
No. No, I've never seen it. That doesn't look bad, actually. Yeah.
It's very sort of stylized.
It's a bit pop-arty.
But it's 60s. Fits in with that. Why doesn't he have a neck? The flame effects are nice. Mm. And Ben and Polly actually look like Ben and Polly.
And he looks like General Cutler.
Yeah. And Hartnell looks very good.
Yes.
Not brilliant for Ben there, but looking pretty good. And Polly's hair seems to have become a bit tousled.
What's been going on? You're going to get it off the ground again. I'm going to give you one more chance or you're going to get killed with
it. I can't fire this rocket and neither can you. How long will it take you to refuel?
Long enough. Then Barclay have specs on.
Maybe he only wears them every so often. Just when he needs to.
I do like this idea that the planet Mondas is absorbing energy from Earth. It's not explained how it's doing it, where it's going, where it's coming from.
The plot makes no sense.
Not that there's a colossal ball of burning hydrogen just a few million miles more that could probably get plenty of energy from.
They do have a bit of problem with teeth, don't they? Because General Cutler looks really good until he opens his mouth and you get Wallace and Gromit's teeth coming out.
I really can't fault the animation here.
It's clearly animation and not trying to be realistic. Mm. But it works really well. The invasion's also like that. Different animation style. But not trying to look realistic. Being fairly unapologetically animated. And it works very well. I'm not sure how well this would work in colour, actually.
I was just thinking the same thing. I actually think it would, because there's plenty... The way they've done it, like I say, it's very pop-arty. I think you would have to tone down the pop-art, the number of different shades in distinct areas on the faces. Otherwise, it would look a little bit odd. I mean, look at Hartnell. You've got about 10 different shades on his face.
And there'd be a massive disjoint between three live-action black and white and then suddenly an animated colour. Things like the faceless ones and the... Macro Terror, where it's completely missing, and then you get the colour works well. Faceless ones, they animate the existing episodes as well, don't they?
Yes, they do. Yeah.
Yeah. So that works as a right the way through. Power of the Daleks works as a right the way through. You give me your word that this young girl will be returned to me when that bomb is safely stowed away. Yeah. And if he's supposed to know about Cybermen by this point, how could he believe that? Keep back! Get away from me! See, that's a bit weird. Because she's just walked across the South Pole with her coat slung over her shoulders. And then the Cyberman knocks her unconscious, and magically she's wearing a coat with arms through the sleeves.
Maybe he dressed her. He was being a gentleman Cyberman.
Or perhaps they've kept the continuity errors on board out of a take of consistency. And that Cyberman in the foreground appears to be playing the theremin. And actually kind of sounds as though he's playing the theremin. Why is he calling himself Unit Delta Plus when... Oh, was it only in the novel that they had names?
No, they are on screen. The credits, the Krang and Zheng and whatever. Have you seen any of the fan animations from the telesnaps where they've taken somebody and...
Yeah, it's...
Oh, I don't know. It's not bad. I could happily watch an episode of that.
I haven't seen one for quite a while.
Because they've done one with Lesterson from Power of the Daleks, and who else have they done recently? But they're absolutely convincing.
Right. Maybe it's the loose the really old loose cannon and things.
Oh, no, no. This is very modern.
Did you ever see the Power of the Daleks one that they did as a live action and modernised it?
No, I saw fragments
yes,
of it.
Yes, I did. And then when I tried to look for it on YouTube, it had all disappeared.
Well, it got forcibly removed by the BBC.
I suspected.
Yeah, Power of the Daleks Reimagined, it was called. With, oh, that bearded fellow that played the Doctor a lot. I can't remember his name. But I did think it was a nice touch that they got him back. When they did the Power of the Daleks animations, they got him to do the live-action reference Doctor for the animation. Oh, that's a nice touch.
The silhouette, yes.
I think it was more the finger on the chin. That was very Hartnell-esque.
Mm. Well, he does a lot of that sort of expression shot in the foreground thing, doesn't he?
It was something he once said to Peter Purvis. Mm. Television, very small. Hands by the face. That's why there's a lot of hands by the face acting.
Yes, because Peter Purvis got the job as Stephen because William Hartnell had got on with him so well during the chase. I mean, wouldn't have got the job if he hadn't been a good enough actor to do the job.
Unlike certain later male companions.
Slightly different reason for casting. And actually, notable female companions from slightly earlier than this who are not blessed with acting chops.
I couldn't possibly comment on how they stayed the course so long. Any interactions with the leading men?
Oh no, I was thinking of Katerina.
I'm surprised she lasted as long as she did.
Well, there was a thing on an episode of Verity where they were saying that there were some people who say the original plan was for Vicky to be the one who stayed for those four episodes and she was to be the one that died in the airlock.
That would have been a nice touch. You would have given a shit.
Yeah. And also with Katerina, it was just, was she flailing about randomly and just happened to hit the wrong thing? Whereas with Vicky, you would know a very definite choice.
Yeah.
I mean, I've no idea whether that's true or not because I'd never heard it as a theory before, but it's quite a nice one.
Well, I know Maureen O'Brien was quite surprised to come back and find that she'd been fired because word had got around that she didn't want to carry on. Well, she wasn't particularly enamoured with it, but she didn't want to leave. Because I think that was the whole... When John Wiles took over as producer, I think clean sweep sort of thing.
Well, except it wasn't really a clean sweep, was it? So, yeah, he got rid of Vicky, but Stephen hung around for pretty much the entirety of his run.
Well, that's why John Wiles didn't last very long. I think he lasted for, what, three or four stories and then gave up because he was dealing with all the hangovers from the previous era and he found the format too rigid. He couldn't actually put his stamp on it as much as he wanted to, which is when... Just slightly sceptical about that because Innes Lloyd came in and immediately put his stamp all over it. So you just have to wonder...
But he put his stamp over it for fairly minor things like changing the titles and that sort of thing until Trout was on board.
And then the historicals disappeared.
Yeah. Because I believe Hartnell liked the historicals because he didn't have scientific techno stuff to... Ben again is being quite proactive like he was in the previous couple of episodes and Polly is just sitting down.
It's Ben's story, this. See, it's always been put forward that the Cybermen are allergic to gold, certainly in the classic series. But in the early stories, God, it was all sorts of different things. In this one, it's radiation.
The next one, it's gravity.
Polly mixed up a Polly cocktail of nail varnish remover. That was how they beat them in the moon base. In Tomb, was it just cold and being sealed back in the tomb that it is?
Partly it was Toberman, and partly it was electricity, wasn't it?
Oh, that was it, electricity, yes. Little wonder they're suffering from the gas when the mask is little more than a hood with a screen on it.
Oh, yes, little baldy bloke must end up in charge because yeah. he's about the only speaking part left. Here's one of the things they use to contact each other. Ben's turn to play the theremin. Oh, no, it isn't Ben doing it, is it? That's a nice effect.
Mondas bubbling away and breaking up.
And second time that year, you'd seen the death of the Earth. Effectively. The Ark.
Oh, it's been that long ago, I can't remember. Quite a good effect of the Cybermen dying as well.
Mm.
So again, there's no real ending to it. It just sort of ends.
Yeah, you see the Earth dying at the end of episode 2 of the Ark.
VHS days, I just cannot remember. I've not seen it for 20 years.
Yeah. And you see, the Ark is one where the TARDIS team turn up, completely fuck things up, bugger off, and then come back and go, oh, was this us? He wants a full report.
Where exactly shall we begin, do you think? The Doctor's had about 5 lines in this whole episode.
And now she's not wearing her coat.
No.
The actual plot of the episode, it's a shame we don't have it, but it's a real shame we don't have this final regeneration bit. And I know we've got that 8mm footage that's been worked up as far as it possibly can. Some feeling all over. I must get back to the
TARDIS. I'd never noticed before we started watching this is wearing... For I think the first time the same clothes that he had on in the first episode. At this point, he nips off for a quick episode with Capaldi. I don't know, he seems to
have lost his sense of humour. It's still hugely atmospheric, even as, guy, as an animated thing.
Wait, open the door! Hey, let us in! You can't leave us here, of all places. Open up!
Doctor!
And in animation, they've sort of followed through on the snow machine effect, haven't they? Oh, this is nicely done.
They've followed this shot for shot. And I've always thought that this is, to be honest, the most impressive regeneration. I just love this whole sequence.
I've always quite liked the way they get both of them to do the same sort of tight-lipped, almost slightly frowning expression.
Oh, Patrick Troughton doesn't get a credit. Bear in mind that this was only the second story of the season, and so they'd find out the week after. It wasn't like most of the classic run where they'd have a regeneration and that was it for 5 or 6 months until the new series.
But I think it was very sensibly done like this because after this the idea of regeneration was established.
Yeah.
I think if end of episode 3 there'd been a regeneration and Troughton had come in with the smugglers, one, you'd be relying on the continuity from a TARDIS team who'd only been introduced in the previous story. But two, completely unknown territory.
Yeah.
And I mean, realistically, at this point, the show is held together by Ben and Polly. And Troughton is brilliant when he comes in, but they're the ones that provide the continuity. They're the ones that get people thinking, yeah, this is still Doctor Who, because it's still got the people that we recognise. Now, within a couple of stories, Troughton has been established. I think listening to the audio as he found his feet from day one.
I've never quite got why the sleeve notes to the CD release say that he'd not really perfected his characterisation, because frankly, he is the Doctor from episode one, right from the start.
I mean, you get a bit of post-regeneration confusion, which there's always been.
But it only lasted half an episode.
Yeah.
And it wasn't it wasn't as overt as it was in future ones.
No, and by the time you get into...
Well, Spearhead, that was half of the story was taken up. In fact, they were still sort of... It was still trying to convince the Brigadier by the end of episode four.
And Kestra Velva.
Yes, the whole story. It's only in the very final line that it... Twin Dilemmas, much the same.
That time of the Rani.
Yeah, when does Mel realise? It's about halfway through, and he settles down a bit. TV movie, the vast majority of that is post-regenerative confusion. Yeah. Christmas in... Yeah, they've all done it. In fact, they've all just taken it and run with it. I think the one that's least confused is actually Tennant to Matt Smith.
Robot, he pretty much hits the ground running.
Yes, yeah, I'll give you that.
But with this, it was entirely down to how good a team and how good a set of actors.
And how good a script. Oh, God, it's still one of the best scripts.
Yeah. But that whole sort of perfect storm bringing everything together. So you've got the script. It looks, from the telesnaps, it looks fantastic. Very good supporting cast. A TARDIS team who are absolutely top of the game.
It's top of my list for stuff to turn up.
Power of the Daleks has always been top of my list for things to turn up.
Years and years ago, a late friend of mine, he introduced me to the VHS recons, and he'd got them all immaculately printed covers with the whole Black Sheep style covers. I couldn't believe it when he opened this canvas bag and he pulled out VHS copies of Power of the Daleks and Evil of the Daleks and The Massacre. And he gave me the two Dalek stories. And he said, go on and watch them, just tell me which one you prefer. At the time, I was more taken with Evil. And I can't believe I was ever more taken with Evil than Power.
Evil has some fantastic moments. I mean, when you get to Skaro, absolutely brilliant. And if it was a four-parter set on Skaro with the bit of the end, that would have been fantastic. Mm. Even if it was a six-parter with a bit less Victoriana.
Yeah, I quite like the Victoriana, but it does go on a bit.
The whole testing of Jamie thing goes on too long.
But Power I have listened to over and over the years. No, the Daleks box set. And then the year after, the Cybermen box set with 10th Planet and the Invasion. And I've got to give kudos to primarily Mark Ayres, because what he's done with the fairly ropey, in some cases, off-air recordings and brought them up to broadcast standard, it's incredible, really.
Yeah, I mean, I listened to Power of the Daleks over and over again, and I've watched the animation, and it's not the best animation in the world, but because it's such a good story.
But in terms of rounding off Hartnell's tenure, bit of a damp squib, but 10th Planet, actually, that's I enjoyed that a lot more than I remember.
Yeah, and it introduced an absolutely classic villain. Some really nice, tight performances. I mean, Robert Beatty was fantastic.
Yes.
Sets looked brilliant.
Again, with no money. They did look good. I mean, the script was pretty good. It's just the regulars weren't really involved beyond Ben.
The script isn't good. The story makes no sense.
No, I mean, the actual dialogue given, it's not dull. It's not Galaxy 4 dull.
A little unfair on Galaxy 4.
Oh, Galaxy 4 is dull. The science makes no sense whatsoever.
And considering it was written by somebody who was brought in as a scientist. And the Cybermen, I hadn't realised, but the Cybermen weren't the original idea for the inhabitants of Mondas. So
I missed that. Was that on the info box?
That was in the info text. They were supposed to be space monks, but because they'd been the monks.
Oh, of
recently,
course, yeah.
So the only bit of really good science in it, i.e. the Cybermen, wasn't the original premise anyway.
Yeah. So... It only remains for one thing. Siri?
I am Persian. Name your price.
Now, this is where your time to shine. What are we thinking? The drag queen index.
The drag queen index has to be a one. There really is nothing. I mean, yes, there's Polly looking very pretty in a sort of fairly shapeless dress. And She is so animated as an actress. There is no resting bitch face. I mean, I suppose you could argue that Cybermen themselves have resting bitch face. But no, there's not really anything here.
I would go with a one on that. So on that note, I think we can wrap it up, unless you've got anything else to observe about 10th Planet.
I don't think so. It's a maligned story. It's a story that has its flaws. It would be really nice if we had episode 4, but actually, there are other episodes I would prefer to recover had we any choice about it.
Well, we've got the important bit. Thanks to Blue Peter, we've got the most important bits of the episode. The regeneration does survive. It was used as a clip in 1973 in an episode of Blue Peter. So thankfully, we've got it. I'd be more miffed. I'd be more keen to get it back if that didn't exist.
But yeah.
No, as you say, better things to look for out there. So thank you for listening, boys and girls. Hope we've entertained you for an hour. We shall be back next time with something else.
Whatever the randomizer is set to. We have one lined up for the randomizer. I can't remember what it is.
I can't either. We've bypassed the randomizer for this one in honour of Earl Cameron. We salute you, sir.
Bye now.
The Exton Moss experiment featured Simon Exton and Ken Moss. All featured television soundtracks are the property of their respective producers, and no infringement of copyright is intended. The programme was recorded in Rishton, Lancashire, and produced by Maverick Productions. For more information, please visit our website at extonmossexperiment.blogspot.com or find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.